We work hard to build a perfect life. But let's face it, we're imperfect people. With imperfect relationships.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. Fortunately, there's a blueprint for building a better us. Together, let's discover God's design for marriage.
Hi, my name is Mike.
And I'm Heather, and we are here to talk to you a little bit about what is a balanced life. And that's really a question that I think we have asked ourselves a lot in life. And when we talk to couples, we hear that a lot is, what is a balanced life and how do I achieve that? And I think one of the things that comes at us a lot when we're looking at this search for a balanced life is all these external pressures that kind of come at us that cause us to feel out of whack a little bit. And one of our favorite illustrations and something that we like to think about when we're talking about how to have a balanced life and how to handle pressure is a pressure cooker. I think we probably all have memories of grandmas cooking with pressure cookers. I love cooking with a pressure cooker because whatever I put in there, it comes out amazing. It doesn't matter. And the thing is, the pressure in the pressure cooker does this amazing work. And so when we look at that and we think about it in our life, we realize that pressure itself isn't bad, but what it is how we handle the pressure and what it does in our life. And if we allow God to really be the center of that pressure for us.
Yeah, and one of the things that we've talked about that helps alleviate that pressure or direct that pressure is building intentionally. We don't think of marriage necessarily as building, but the whole title of the series is Building a Better Us. When it comes to managing pressure and managing your life, you have to build your marriage intentionally to manage those pressures. We do it in the architectural world all the time, right? You would never build a house and say, hey, you do your part and I'll do my part and let's see how it comes out in the end. You always have a plan. You always have a direction that you're heading and we agree. And then we do our thing and we're constantly on the same page. Psalm 127, verses 1 and 2 says this. It says, unless the Lord builds a house, those that build it labor in vain. I think transparently, I would say I've done a lot of vain building in my life because we haven't been on the same page all the time. I think every married couple we've ever talked to has experienced that where they frustrate themselves. They've hurt each other. I think there's some practical things that we can do, though, to help make that a better transition, a better intentional build. What are some of those things?
Absolutely. One of the things that we really seek to do is not let the busyness of life push us around. We can have a ton of things that will compete for our attention, our children, extracurricular activities, church life, family. There's so many things that we all face. But the thing is, we really have to pick our priorities and look and see what is most important. You know, in Joshua 24:15, it says, you have to choose for this day who you will serve. And when we look at that and we balance that in the light of everything that we have going for us, we have to say, what is the best thing? You know, not a lot of the things that we're doing are bad. You know, a lot of times we'll look on and say, I'm doing a lot and it's all really good. But the problem comes when that tries to take us away from the priorities and what is most important in our life.
Right. And one of the things that we've talked about is writing down your priorities.
Absolutely. Making a list and writing it down. You know, I would say that's something really great to do even right now is to look on and write it down. Talk together and say, what are the things that we really seek in our family, in our marriage? That is the most important. And when you actually write those things down and you can see them, it really gives you a great picture of where you need to focus your heart.
Yeah, it's part of what makes you build intentionally.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that we've said is that you have to intentionally create margin in your marriage. When you're wrestling with balance, I don't know about your life, but most people I know don't find themselves with a ton of margin on their hands.
Right.
When you're in this young stage of being married, or if you've been married for even 30 and 40 years, there are things, great things that are pulling for your attention. If you're not actively, intentionally creating margin in your world, you're going to find yourself on that hamster wheel, like you said. The interesting thing is that we believe that if you create that margin, you create God room. I think it was Franklin Graham who said that when you create a little bit of margin, you give God room to do amazing things in your life. The difficult part is saying no. That idea of creating priorities, it is hard because it allows you to look on the priorities, help you to look back and say, okay, this is a really good thing. Do I want to say no to this? Is this going to take away from one of my greater priorities? One of the things that we see a lot, and that I think we've experienced, is that unintentionally really, really good things will take away from your marriage. I would never say, hey, my work, my kids are more important than my spouse. My family is more important than my spouse. But by actions, they speak louder than my words, where if I put that above you, because I know that you're going to be okay with it, my priorities are getting mixed up. And I watch that margin shrink away, and we look back and we go, why is my life spinning crazy? One of the other things that we've talked about is this idea of choosing to cheat.
Right.
We've talked about that a lot.
Yeah, for sure.
You're going to cheat certain things in your life. And that might sound like a weird phrase, but the idea of cheating is I can either cheat my hobbies that are down my priority list way down here that are still good and great things, or I can cheat the person that is most important to me outside of my savior. And I found myself guilty of that, of cheating you. We've had conversations about that. It's gone both ways where how did we get here? We have to choose to cheat something. The question is, are you doing it intentionally or are you doing it accidentally? One of the illustrations we talked about is a story by a professor in college who talked to me about maintaining tension. And I remember sitting with him at 19 years old and trying to balance my really busy and difficult life. And he sat down and he was probably laughing at me, but he was very gracious. And he said this phrase, he said, Mike, get to choose to maintain the tension in life. Mm-hmm. And he gave me this picture of holding on to a rope with both hands. He says, right now, what you're asking me is if you can let go of one half of the rope because it would be easier. But God's called you to hold both of those ropes, he said. So even though it feels like your arms are going to be ripped off, he goes, you're called to stand there and hold that and to maintain that tension, which is really what balancing life is all about, is standing there saying, but this is difficult. This is hard. This is even frustrating and it even hurts. But if God's called me to this, I have to be able to do this because of the person that I love and because I love him. That maintaining tension is a really important point when you're talking about your spouse.
Absolutely. And I think when we think about the tension, a lot of times we want to look at our spouse and think that they're causing the complication or that they are the enemy in this. And what we have to remember is that we fell in love for a reason.
Right.
You know, we made a covenant with each other. And when we think about this balanced life and this tension and everything we do, we have to really go back to the basics and really value our friendship. And something that we've really purposed to do is to stay best friends, you know, and we have to be active about that. That's something that you were saying earlier. We really have to build upon, you know, there's this lost art of dating. And I think when we have all these things that can come into play and these things that can affect us, when we think about dating and just going back to the basics, it's really important. Just being able to spend time together one-on-one, just being able to laugh together.
Yeah.
You know, when we laugh, you know, the proverb said that a cheerful heart is like good medicine. And just laughing when we have all these tensions, like you're saying, that come at us, just laughing together is so good for each other.
Yeah, it's biblical.
Absolutely.
Right? It's something that's super important. It's way undervalued. It's way underestimated. There should be a premium placed on laughter within your marriage. That cuts through tension and helps you create balance in a way that I don't know I can explain. But it also leads me to another conversation we've had, which is this idea of your creative energy.
Right.
Is an interesting thought because in my own personal life, I have found when it comes to priorities, when it comes to what I'm thinking about, dreaming about, planning, I find that the world is constantly, the circumstances around us are constantly pulling my creative energy to other things outside of building a better us.
Mm-hmm.
As a man, I find that I can find myself daydreaming. I can find myself thinking about things that are outside and I won't spend the energy. It was a few years ago that I was convicted by that.
Right.
And I realized that all my thoughts and ideas were going outside of my home and I wasn't giving my best creative energy to us. It sounds like a little thing. It sounds like maybe even a minor thing that can be brushed by the wayside, but it's not. It's central to where your heart and where your dreams are at. When you're laughing, it fuels that fire. When you're fighting, it pulls it away. And that's totally understandable because every couple have those disagreements. Sometimes they're major. Laughter heals that. And then focusing on what you're dreaming about,
right,
those dreams, is really important. Part of what frustrates us, though, is that we have different love languages.
Oh, so,
right?
Different. Yes.
Like
just
opposite. Part of what's interesting about those love languages, you've never seen that. It's a great assignment to do for homework. Go online, look up the 5 love languages, take the test really quick. What you realize is that you can be speaking a different language from your spouse, and I speak a completely different language from you. And that can be laughable and funny in this moment. It can be devastating and very, very hurtful. And you can feel unloved, both of us could, at times if we're not speaking the same love language. And that's really priceless when it comes to how we build this thing.
Right. We absolutely have completely different love languages. And that was something that we really had to learn early on because I would be trying to give him love in a way that he wasn't understanding, but it's what made sense to me. And when we looked at the love languages and we sought to love each other the way they feel it, we really noticed our friendships deepen. And when we would create this bond and this friendship that would be even deeper and more intimate, Lord, we saw that our intimacy increased because our friendship, we just wanted to spend time together. We wanted to laugh together. We wanted to be together. And so we developed an even greater bond in that way also.
I think that's something that I didn't realize when I was younger and newly married, is that the friendship was going to fuel that fire into what our intimacy was going to look like. I think most people, most men don't realize that. It's not celebrated in our society that, hey, this is how you build passion and sexual intimacy. It doesn't work that way, but it does work that way. Friendship fuels that. Unfortunately, what can happen a lot of times in our marriage is that we have unmet expectations.
Right.
And I know a lot of couples that we talk to deal with that, where they're frustrated, they're wounded, their balance of their life is thrown off because they have a set of expectations or things that have been done against them. And so they don't know how to pray and forgive. I think those are two really important points when it comes to maintaining that balance.
Right.
I've told people, and I've laughed at you, that for years, I think Heather's prayed for me. There's been plenty of things that needed to change in my life. And I remember a couple of times coming to you and saying, hey, have you been praying about this for me? I feel like there's something changing in my heart. Unfortunately, a lot of times the way most couples and even us try to attempt change is by coming at the person and saying, hey, you need to change this. I'm going to confront this. It's good to talk about it, but prayer is a very important thing.
Absolutely.
And then forgiveness is an unbelievably undervalued piece to maintaining balance. 1 Peter 5:8 says this. It says, cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you. It's an unbelievably powerful verse, especially when it comes to forgiving and praying, because what that does is it allows you to take those cares and throw them at your Savior rather than heap them on your spouse. What that does for creating balance and freedom and friendship within your marriage when you don't expect your spouse to solve all that is unexplainable. It found a lot of couples, we see a lot of couples that take their spouse and put them in the place of their Savior.
Right.
And there's not much worse than that, because what you do when you put your spouse in the place of your Savior is that you make them the person supposed to solve all of your problems.
Mm-hmm.
They're supposed to be the person that fixes everything for you. Your spouse is not supposed to be your Savior.
Absolutely. So we want to leave you with this big idea, which is that we experience the greatest balance in our marriage when Jesus is the center of our priorities.